Today in World Literature, we focus on the literature of New Zealand. We focus on the poetry of Alan Kernow and the fiction of Janet Frame, Patricia Grace, and Witi Amira. Christchurch is the capital of the small nation of New Zealand, and it is in the Canterbury Museum at Christchurch that the New Zealand writer Alan Kernow sets his poem, The Skeleton of the Great Moa, in the Canterbury Museum, Christchurch. The poem is a sonnet. It is, in fact, an Elizabethan sonnet, and therefore it is highly structured. It is a meditation of an extinct bird, a bird that could not exist in a landscape, a bird that was not suited. There are multiple meanings in the poem, of course, as there are in all poems, about the idea of who is standing and who has fallen here. Clearly, we need to be aware in Kernow's poem that he's interested in us realizing that New Zealand is quite often referred to as the antipodes, the land that is down under or upside down. Kernow is interested in having, perhaps not himself, but some child born in a marvelous year who will learn the trick of standing upright here. Specifically, he's interested in the idea of identity, the idea of self-realization that an individual might find in the antipodes in being able to, as it were, stand upright or stand up to, not being down under, but stand on an equal basis with Europe itself, particularly with Great Britain. The poem, I think, speaks for many immigrant New Zealanders who have, I think, trouble feeling at home in their new country historically. It is useful, of course, to compare this piece to something such as Mr. Parker's Valentine or Bruce Dawes' poem, The Migrants, in which characters are very uneasy with their new surroundings and in which characters find themselves troubled by, again, as we found in Australian literature, the recognition that their European past does not equip them with everything that they might need to be equipped with to triumph in a new situation. As well, in looking at the literature of New Zealand, we might want to have a look at Janet Frame's short story, The Day of the Sheep. Janet Frame's story is a story of place. It's a place of a home, of an environment, of a society. Nance is a middle-class woman in a very conventional middle-class home, in a very conventional middle-class marriage. On the particular day when the story opens, it should not have rained because she finds herself inside the door of the wash house, and there she finds a sheep in the middle of a very urban environment. Sheep, Frame writes, are silly animals. They're so scared and stupid. They stand still and do nothing, or else go round and round getting nowhere. It becomes clear that the sheep has a great relationship to the psychology of Nance herself. The sheep is clearly a figure for Nance. Nance is unhappy about her present home, about her conventional life, about her conventional marriage to Tom. Tom, just like Nance's cousin Nora, knows where he belongs in the world. His dream is the dream of winning a lottery and of having a more secure existence than he has now. Nance, I think, is a very lonely character, a very isolated character. And in that way, comparisons can quickly be made to Patrick White's Clay, or again to Elizabeth Jolie's Mr. Parker's Valentine, in terms of marital relationships, in which the wife is very often portrayed as passive, as unable to act. Relationships in which a wife is trapped in a marriage with a husband who is insensitive, a husband who is conventional, a husband who is in many ways unequal to the imaginative nature of the wife herself. In New Zealand, along with the writers such as Kernow and Frame, we must also take account of the particular nature of Maori writers. Specifically, to look at this, we can look at a piece by Patricia Grace called And So I Go. It's difficult to see this piece as a short story or a poem, because certainly there are elements of both. The piece utilizes a call-and-response narrative structure. On one hand, the traditional communal values of the Maori ask the speaker of the poem to stay among a place where it is quiet, where it is warm, where it is safe. The woman in the poem realizes, though, that she must go, hearing, as it were, European voices or voices that are not particularly of the Maori culture. The second speaker attempts to respond to the anxieties raised by the Maori culture, attempts to comfort, and attempts to say it's not so much as a going away from, but a carrying forth of Maori values into another culture. It is this carrying forth of those values, indeed, that is the subject of a particularly engaging short story by Witi Imira called His First Ball. In this particular piece, we might be reminded of the humor of Colin Johnson, because indeed here we have another satiric piece that uses humor to critique the society. The work, of course, portrays, as does Colin Johnson's piece, the relationship between settlers and indigenous people. In this case, we find a young Maori worker, Tutu Werapapa, who discovers in his mailbox an invitation to that most white, most upper-class genteel of places, Government House. He is being asked, as it were, to his first ball. He's instructed on what to do by a very comic cast of characters, among them a Mrs. Simmon, who is white and middle class, who knows which forks to use and who lays out her own tableware to try to give young Tutu an idea of how to behave at Government House. But there's also enormous humor in here, in that Tutu is taught how to dance by Desiree Dawn, a six-foot transvestite who tries to bring him into the culture and on how he's supposed to act at Government House. The story then shifts to Government House itself, and it is very clear that the author is putting Tutu Werapapa up as a character of tokenism. He becomes a sort of superficial gesture to a white middle-class or upper-class group as being someone who is included, one person included to represent the many. It's quite clear that at Government House, he becomes the object of curiosity more than the object of scorn. And as everybody comes and mispronounces his name, and he sort of uncomfortably adjusts to the situation, he hears a fern talking to him, and turn around, he finds that there's a young woman behind it, Joyce, who was last ball's or last season's curiosity. Joyce is a sociology student. And of course, Tutu, who is warm and generous and indicative of the Maori people, asks her to come out from behind the fern and dance. And as she comes out of her crouching position, he realizes that she rises and rises and rises, and oh, how enormously tall she becomes. Nevertheless, he takes her to the dance floor, and in dancing with her, becomes very comfortable. It's very interesting that the ending of the story suggests something rather broad, that there may be a chance that white culture and Maori culture may be able to have unification in terms of social change. Tutu enjoys a comfortable dancing at the end of the piece. Tutu is strong enough to maintain his own individuality. "Look," says Tutu at the end, "how about another dance?" Joyce looked at him in disbelief. "You're a sucker for punishment, aren't you?" she muttered. "Why," Tutu bowed mockingly. "Well, for one thing, it would be just divine." At that, Joyce let out a peal of laughter. She stood up again. "Thank you," Joyce whispered. "Then, you know, this is my first ball." And Tutu smiled. "It's my first ball, too." He said, "From now on, balls like these will never be the same again." He took her hand, and the band began to wail a sweet but oh-so-mean saxophone solo as he led her to the floor. Certainly, there are cultural differences among these people. Certainly, there are differences of class. There are enormous differences of gender. And there are differences of race. But the story's final image of Tutu dancing with Joyce, I think, is also an image of the idea of Maori white unity and the possibility there for social change. It is very important then to see that in New Zealand writing, as in Aboriginal writing, there are tensions. The tensions are severe. White settlers quite frequently find themselves uncomfortable in this new situation. Their isolation is great. Nevertheless, the idea for reformation, for unity, and for hope is possible.
Before leaving the literature of Australia and Oceania, we should also turn to that of New Guinea and Samoa. In this course, the literature of New Guinea is represented by Kama Kirpi's Cargo. From Samoa, Albert Wendt brings us Poliuli. Cargo is a tale about the appearance of Western commodities, but as well, Cargo is a tale about the penetration of capitalist patterns of consumption. Abram and Cain, our protagonists, try to locate the cargo from their dead ancestors. Their misunderstanding, however, is revealing. Indeed, wealth rests with their ancestors, but not in terms of modern consumerist society. Albert Wendt's novel is as well symbolically significant. The protagonist of his novel, a 76-year-old patriarch named Falesa Osave, revolts against his life. Pretending he is possessed by demons, he decides to unburden himself of his agia, or his community. The theme of the individual's struggle against social conformity is apparent in many of the writers in this section of the course, in Patrick White, in Janet Frame, and in Albert Wendt. Indeed, it is the theme of struggle that is perhaps most unifies Australian authors.